first is number 9 on your agenda, 78 to 80 sales for Trattoria Pulcinella. Giovanni Oliva has applied to the licensing board for the sale and transfer of the wine and malt license. That was the one that was at Saibo Panamori. You know, Marissa was going to open a restaurant there, and unfortunately that could not work out. And so these folks are going to open a new restaurant called Trattoria Pulcinella. They are represented by attorney Bill Farella.
Yes.
I have the... Sure. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. We do know that neighborhood notification was done, and people were well notified. Thank you. Bill always does a good job of keeping me informed.
It's not pretty.
No, why don't you just take some, just pass it. We can pass this way. These are all the same menus, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then each row can have one and pass it along. How about that? Bill? I think each row can have one. We got to put it. Okay.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Bill Perrol. I'm representing Giovanni Oliva, who's standing next to you. Giovanni's got a long history in the North End, has family in the North End, but more importantly, has decided to open the second restaurant by the name of Pulcinella, Trattoria Pulcinella, which he will explain. He's had Trattoria Pulcinella in Cambridge for 20 years. And had the opportunity to secure 7880 Salem Street, which has been mentioned by Donna, was the site that Marissa Yoko, who I had represented, was going to open as a restaurant. Prior to that, it had been a beauty parlor, tanning salon location. The property is owned by Chris Young, who's doing a considerable amount of construction work as far as supporting the building, etc. The building was in fairly difficult shape, and Giovanni at the same time is doing the interior work. There's a plan going around now. It's nearly identical to Marisa's plan. In other words, it has 42 seats, that's the same. It has the kitchen in the basement, that's the same. We have passed around a draft, of the first draft of the menu. Hearing the term called mozzarella bar, it's part of the concept that Giovanni likes, which is the making of mozzarella, having imported mozzarella, but it's a visual thing, a lot of small plates, antipasti, cured meats, etc. You'll see that on the list, almost all of which is homemade, made at the restaurant by Giovanni's staff. The hours of operation for this restaurant are planned as 11 a.m. starting for lunch until 11 at night and 12 on the weekend, which again are the same hours that were approved for Marisa's license.
Could you just give that one more time, the hours?
It will eventually have lunch service starting at 11 a.m. Okay. And it will close at 11 p.m. weeknights and 12 on the weekend. And as mentioned, those are the hours that have been approved for this license at that location for the reason. And other than that, if you don't know Giovanni, you can ask him some questions. He's got a wonderful restaurant.
Well, we start with the council first. So did you want to add anything?
No.
Okay. Council members?
You say everything.
Anybody have any questions?
Yes.
No, wait, just a second. We'll in a minute. Go ahead, Ian.
Okay, what's your signage? What kind of signage?
We're going to be a painting the wall.
Outside?
Just outside, yes.
Outside? Is
painter.
Is it going to be?
They're going to be a very small awning.
You're going to have an awning?
Yes, okay. A very small, but each window.
No neon?
No.
And have you made arrangements to have trash pickup?
Yes, sure. Every day.
Every day.
Yes.
Any other council members have any questions?
Billy, you said the hours were pre-approved for this license. I know that someone had previously come to, someone else was supposed to go on that spot. Is that what you're talking about? You're saying she was pre-approved for the license?
The license transferring to him has the same capacity, hours of operation. And the one exception on the floor plan is where her handicapped accessible bathroom is, has been flipped around a little. But other than that, it's the same floor plan.
What are the hours of operation?
11 a.m. Starting for lunch until 11, weeknights 12 on the weekend.
I have a question. License, the previous license was never really activated at, by the...
She never did the construction.
So is there any sort of policy against, you know, about having it be an active license at all? Is there a certain time frame in which the license had to have been previously used?
Generally, it has to be transferred to the year.
Generally?
In other words, every license comes up for renewal in November of each year. At which time you have to inform the board what it is you're doing with the license. In other words, an activist checks off the box and says, we're open and operating. If you're in the process of build up or, you know, the process of transfer, you notify them that they're in the process of transferring the license to whatever you're doing during the time. You know, some places close for renovation for a number of months, you have to notify the board. So anytime the license is inactive, you have to give a notice to the board letting them know.
So last November it was notified that it was...
I can't remember when she was approved exactly, and we would have filed this, we would have filed this application likely somewhere around December, January.
We don't foresee that being any sort of issue at all?
No, as a matter of fact, we've already had to get it.
The license?
Licensing board. Yeah, we were supposed to be here last month. Giovanni had to go to Italy, so we pushed it over to this month. We asked the board to hold, even though we had the hearing, we asked the board to hold the decision after the two boards.
Thank you, that's very respectful.
I know that he's under construction, fixing and everything, but does he have a special permit to work on Sunday?
I don't know the answer. Who's the contractor? But there's two contractors working. One is working with Chris Young, who's the landlord, who's been doing the...
Inside that place?
It depends on what it is. He's doing the exterior, the roof, the flooring, windows. In other words, the shell of the building, most of that is landlocked, whereas Giovanni will be doing the kitchen. Right.
But I'm talking about inside.
Yeah, I don't know who it is that's doing the work. We can ask Giovanni.
But is there any way he could find out?
Yes. You do need a special permit to work on Sandy Austin.
It is a residential area. You know what I'm saying?
They don't have a Sunday permit. If you see them working, you should call 911.
Do you know what kind of work it is?
Drilling and hammering.
They don't have a permit.
Sawing. They're inside. You can hear Sunday morning, 10 o'clock in the morning. So well, the residents tolerate so much, then you have to have these people, don't misunderstand me, come in and open up a business, and then you want to... Yeah.
No, we'll check with Chris. Yeah, as I say, Chris is the landlord. If they're drilling and stuff, it sounds like it may be the foundation work, et cetera. But I'll check with him tomorrow and find out who the contractor is. If you see a truck with a name on it, too.
I don't see any truck. All I see is guys with, barrels and emptying it and just drilling inside.
And again, it's the whole sense. You have to get a special permit.
Yeah, you get a special permit for media work.
Any other council members have any questions?
Just one other question. I'm just curious, Giovanni, you own a restaurant in Cambridge for how long?
Yes, for 20 years.
20 years. Have you been involved in the community at all?
Yes, in Cambridge. I live in Cambridge.
So I mean, just in terms of, like, you know, how you may be a good business owner here, the ways you could see yourself engaging?
I never have any problem with health department. I never have any problem with the liquor license and things like that. I never said that minors.
Do you engage all community organizations
sure,
or anything
sure,
like that?
We support a lot of local organizations.
Okay.
And Giovanni's family is here.
My wife, she's a family here.
So we can continue to, you know, supply local officials.
Again, are you going to have open windows?
The window you can open.
You can open.
Yeah, but they're not down.
But they are not down to the.
Okay.
To the street.
What about trash?
I understand.
Trash, we already.
Stored inside, taken out nightly, picked up.
Every day.
Okay, so somebody, yes, go ahead.
Yes. I just want to get this straight. You are taking over the first floor of the corner of Stillman and Salem.
Yes.
Are you planning to go up a second floor, and are you planning to do what's called a roof deck similar to Fury's? Yes or no?
No.
Okay, because I was under the impression that this was going to be an outdoor thing on the second floor. If it's private, that's wonderful. But we have enough noise and madness in this area that no one wants to admit. And I am happy for all these restaurant owners, and I eat in all these restaurants. But our quality of life has been destroyed down the north end. I want to make that very clear.
Anybody else have any questions?
You have to get rezoned.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the.
Again, Chris isn't here. I'm speaking for Chris, only because I've done work for Chris as well. Is he has looked at that building because it's a one-story building about future occupancy. Whether he ever goes anywhere with that, I don't know, to be honest with you. Whether it be apartments above it or something else. There's nothing that's immediate of the moment. But Chris is contemplating looking at that issue if in fact it's possible. So as far as Giovanni, his lease is only for the ground.
I just lease for the first floor. That's it.
Anybody else have any questions? Is anybody ready to make a motion?
I motion to support the transfer. Sale and transfer of the wine and malt license from Chivo Conamori to the Trattoria Pulcinella.
And I'll second it.
All in favor? Okay, so unanimous. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Good luck with your business, and we expect you to be a good neighbor.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is 371 to 373 Hanover Street, formerly Casa di Stile. Nick Varano has applied to the Zoning Board of Appeals for zoning relief to change the use of the first floor from a retail clothing store to a restaurant with takeout service. And again, represented by Attorney Bill Farrell.
Just give me one moment. Nick is not here. Mother's name was too good. He came down with a pack of adults this morning. I don't want to say so. So he apologizes. This is a zoning issue. To explain, the location was the clothing store that was done over not too long ago, Casa di Stile, on Hanover Street, directly next door to Strega Restaurant, which Nick has operated now for the last 10 years. When that came available, Nick was interested in the space, quite honestly, originally as an expansion of Strega, because Strega has been, as I think we know, very successful, and he was hoping he could get some more space. Neither the landlord of the building that Strega is in, nor the condominium association that this space is in, would agree to reach the walls between them. So that he could potentially connect the two spaces into the one restaurant. So the alternative to that is that Nick is proposing a location to be known as Cafe Strega, or Strega Cafe, depending on the day of the week. and it's going to be a light service cafe, hopefully, that he can use in conjunction with his restaurant, meaning it will operate as a cafe, meaning opening at 7 in the morning for coffee and light coffee shop service. Starting at 11, he will have a pizza oven, which he is presuming of the moment will be actually electric, and he will have pizza and associated items that he can make in the oven itself. He will not have open flame stoves. He will not have that type of venting because he's not able to put it in that space. So the type of cooking that will take place will primarily be with the oven and assembly of things like salads, roasted vegetables, once again, antipasti, like cured meats, prosciutto, and so on and so forth. He is hoping that the cafe will not only service the community naturally, but that will be of assistance to him at the restaurant, meaning that when people are waiting outside, rather than waiting outside, they can wait at the cafe. They can have an appetizer of some type at the cafe. Rather than having dessert in the restaurant, they can go into the cafe and have the dessert and coffee in there, freeing up his dining tables in the restaurant. As mentioned, naturally, it's not solely for the use of the clientele in Strega's restaurant, but open to anyone. He just thinks that this would allow him some more flexibility for what he has currently as his business. It only has 10 seats. And those seats are, if you look at the diagrams that were by, called rail seats. They're against one wall with the short rail, so that if you have something, you can sit there and have it. It's not tables. It will be an open area for the display of the products that he makes in the oven, so that you will see the front window will have, you know, pizza, flatbreads, calzone, things of that sort, and that area going up that side will also be display area for things like the antipasti, and so on and so forth. So it's a rather small space if you're familiar with it at all. It is what you see. It doesn't go back further than that distance. How many square feet? I'm going to guess roughly it's about 400 square feet, so it's a pretty small store with a single bathroom to the right, and that's the extent of the space. He has some small storage area in the basement. He has not applied for an alcohol beverage license for this space because we're doing the zoning. So after we do the zoning, he will, and we'll let you know now, contemplate whether he will apply for his beer and wine license, most likely, for this location, either one that is available or one that he has to purchase, but that will be round two, which we will come back for at a later time if the zoning is approved. And again, as far as hours of operation, 7 in the morning for coffee service. Coffee service will be all day. The regular cafe service all day until 11 weeknights and 12 on the weekend.
For the weekends?
About 12 o'clock.
May I ask a question?
Sure, go right ahead.
Is he planning on any way to get some of the heat produced by the oven out of the environment, or is he just going to hold it in there?
No, I presume the location of the oven is where there is an alcove in the back,
so
between the buildings.
Will there be an exhaust system for that?
It won't go to the roof. He tells me the way the electric ovens work is that they only have to be vented out.
Are there windows outside of that space? Are there residents? Is that an air shaft for a building?
It's a back. It's a rear yard for that building and the buildings that are on Webster Court.
Well, I hope he doesn't burn anything because there's going to be smoke in that air shaft for sure. I don't know how the city would approve such a thing without having proper exhaust.
Well, And as I'm saying, it's, he will not be, so you know, is, he will not be putting a Ansel vent system in the condominium association. Hasn't allowed to do that. And that's why he's looking at.
But you could burn things in electrical as much as you can do with gas.
Oh, you can burn anything.
Yeah, so I'm just surprised that this would allow just a vent to an air shaft that obviously probably most likely has windows on it and not proper exhaust.
They don't put a stove with that fire lit.
There's no fire lit.
What is it?
No, what he's showing, that is a fire lit, some sort of a chest. Those are plates, like hot plates. So he has, he's agreed to the whole plate.
It does look, it's all on the drawings, it does look like a fire lit on the drawings also.
Yeah, yes, no, he can't have the fire lit because he has no wood.
Do you do a tabletop fire lit?
You might do that at home. I don't think you could do that.
Any other council members have any questions? Okay, I'm opening it up to anyone who has a question out there. More questions?
Billy, actually, I got a question.
Okay, go ahead.
I mean, in light of what George said, you get a denial letter through inspectional services, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have a denial letter. They must read the footprint of the retail space, right? So they must, I mean, it's a good question what George is asking.
Yeah, no, the answer, Steve, to give you the best answer I can, is that the issues, the build-out issues, aren't handled in the zoning section of this. This, in other words, the zoning that we're here is a conditional use to change this over to a restaurant use. Issues that could come up in terms of design, et cetera, can come up at any time, meaning, you know, once he starts applying for permits, then, you know, whether he has enough electricity, whether he has the right type of design there for hand sinks and all that, those aren't zoning issues. They're building code issues, or they're just simple health code issues, or whatever else they are. And they have to be, in other words, if you don't have the hood,
I understand.
You know, it doesn't come up as a zoning issue, but it will come up as a building code or a health code issue.
No, I understand. Believe me, every time I think I have this stuff down, I there's always something that confuses me. But no, I think it's a great idea in the spot that, I mean, that's been vacant for a while, and I think it's a great option for people to get on. It alleviates the congestion on the sidewalk for one thing, because he does a pretty good business at Strega on Hanover Street. But you know, I know he's not here. He's a good owner. He's an accessible guy. You know, he's not one of these guys that runs away. You know, you give him a phone call, you have a problem, which is very rare. You know, he's accessible, and he's easy to deal with, and he's a good business neighbor, and he's a very generous business in the community. And I was just talking before the meeting, Naha Shoes out of business. It's very difficult for these retail spots to maintain on Hanover Street. It's the rents are very high, and you know, I know people get, people put their guard up when they see another retail spot being converted into a restaurant, and I guess I can understand that argument as well. But on Hanover Street, where the rents are, you know, some spots the rents are $10,000, $12,000 a month, it's difficult to be a successful business. I mean, you can't sell T-shirts. And believe me, if anyone can sell T-shirts and clothes, Nikki can sell anything. But it's hard for a business to survive. I just saw Naha, the signs on the wall on window the other day, and it just goes to show you that it's extremely difficult to do retail. I know there's been a debate within the neighborhood about retail versus restaurants, and it's a fair argument. I mean, people feel that we have too many restaurants in the neighborhood. I don't disagree, but at the same time, that place will remain vacant. I mean, the only thing that can stay competitive in there is probably someone who's going to sell food. So I think it's a good idea.
Bill?
Sorry.
You finished, Stephen? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm good.
Quick question about, Stephen mentioned sidewalk congestion. There has been issues in the past with Strega, and I hope there won't be a dislocation of tent signs on the sidewalk, which are obstructing the summertime tourist flow or just blocking traffic. I mean, I hope that Nick will abide by rules that prohibit the tent signs on the sidewalk. It's going to add now a second door front that will arguably have more of a potential for developing a line than Casa di Stile did. So that's a very heavily trafficked block, and I'd like to see, I'd like him to hear again our concern that these tent signs obstruct traffic flow even more than the lines away from his restaurant.
Well, you've heard me say many of me. So-called sidewalk furniture is illegal, whether it's a tent sign, whether it's a planting, whether it's, you know.
Well, his bench is well.
Sorry?
His bench.
Well, I'm saying whatever you have on the sidewalk, unless you can show me a permit from Department of Public Works for occupying the city sidewalk, they're illegal. And I think Cole might add to that that I don't know of any permits that have been issued any establishment is not that.
Well, that's my point.
I'll leave it.
But we still do have tent signs. And I want to make sure the Strega is seriously advised by the board.
I'm hearing what you're saying, Bill, and I'm confirming that.
And you're going to pass out on the minutes.
I am.
That actually came out as part of the presentation by the students from Northeast University, congestion on sidewalks and how difficult it is for pedestrian traffic. And some of it is, you know, they're putting all kinds of things on the sidewalks.
It's a creeping growth.
Yes. It is. But you heard it here from Attorney Ferrello. They're illegal. Everybody's doing their thing, but no one's enforcing it.
You're asking now for a voter support on the change of occupancy for the space.
Correct.
You are not. These drawings haven't been approved by the city. Have they been reviewed by the city? Have they been approved by the city?
They're approved by the city for zoning purposes.
But not by the building department for an occupancy for a restaurant.
And the zoning will not give you relief from the building code unless you ask for relief from the building code. Meaning he hasn't received anything saying that he has any building code issues to go to the zoning board for. So it's only a zoning request.
Yeah, I just find that, you know, exhausting the kitchen fumes from any kitchen into an air shaft, it's just opening the door for all sorts of problems with the neighbors there. Cooking makes fumes. Whether you cook with electrical, you cook with gas, you know, you produce fumes, you know. I just don't know how would that be allowed. And I don't understand why the property wouldn't allow the chimney to go up to the roof. If they are willing to change the occupancy to have the space off as a restaurant downstairs, I don't understand.
This building has no backyard.
I understand, but they do have an air shaft.
They have the air shaft, and then there's a backyard to the other buildings.
No, but the air shaft, each building surrounding the air shaft should have rights to that air shaft of some nature. So if you have an air shaft, then you're going to vent. Let's put it this way. If you don't have rights to vent to an air shaft,
no.
You can't put an exhaust to
the
air shaft.
No, but the other building, what I'm saying, Judge, is this building has a piece of land that's used as the air shaft, but that air shaft goes on to the backyards of the building on Hanover Street. The buildings of Webster Court, so it's open in the back. It's not just a shaft between the buildings.
Big hours.
No, but I'm saying, but this particular building doesn't have a backyard, doesn't have an area that really would allow itself to have a vent, so that's a restriction that they've placed on it. There's no back of the building. They're building directly abuts.
Like I say, I think Nick is a great guy. He does a great job with his businesses. I just don't understand how an owner of a piece of real estate would allow a certain use in an environment which requires certain mechanical devices rather than an exhaust system, and not allow there not be a way to exhaust those fumes. Whether you're cooking with electrical, whether you're cooking with gas, whether you're cooking with a bonfire. No, I understand. But I mean, we are voting on allowing an occupancy change in a piece of property, and I think that the responsibility we have, again, is to the neighbors and their abutters to make sure that there is proper exhaust of that space.
Okay, any other council members have any comments or questions? Anybody?
Oh, just the signage.
I knew I was waiting for that.
I wish I knew.
He's on here on the street.
Yeah, I let's put it this way. If the zoning were to happen, he has to come back for the liquor license, at which time he can address the signage, because I'm sure he hasn't even given that any thought at the moment, so.
Anyone else?
I don't see, I mean, personally, I don't see this alleviating any congestion on the sidewalk there. I do think, you know, especially with capacity of 10.
But it has a capacity of 19 seating.
Seating for 10.
So you could have, presumably, like 6 or 7 other people standing, and a couple of people working.
So I don't think that it would alleviate, I don't congest, I do think it would bring, you know, more people, especially if he's going to succeed and have a strong business, you have to have some sort of flow of customers. So I just, I actually have a question about Bill, too, about the outdoor space, and you did clarify that around how that would be used. Ultimately, if you're ready to get a permit, you're right, you can't use any sort of.
I'll give you a little personal opinion. I don't see the city starting to close those gates to allow things on the sidewalk, so.
Anybody else? Maybe you'd like to entertain a motion?
Yes.
Yes, we did.
I motion to support.
Now, what are you supporting? Where was this?
Question with the takeout service.
Stephen, you want to make your full motion, please?
I'd like a motion to support for zoning relief to change the use of the first floor from a retail clothing store to a restaurant with takeout.
And do I have a second?
And I'll second it.
Okay. All in favor of changing the zoning, of supporting zoning relief to change the use of the first floor from a retail clothing store to a restaurant with takeout service? All in favor? Jonathan, do you have your hand up?
Yes, sir.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, and all opposed? Okay. 7-1, congratulations. Tell Nick that we're sorry he's not feeling well. And
don't let you know
the council will see you back for your worker license. Hanover Street, this formerly the site of the Hanover News. Jennifer Pittori has filed the application of the Zoning Board of Appeals for zoning relief to change the use of the first floor from a retail store to a restaurant with takeout service. And the last sentence needs to be changed. She has not applied to the licensing board for wine and malt license at this location. Right?
We have not. We will this week.
She intends to do so in the future, but it is not. So that's a mistake on the agenda. So it tends to apply, has not applied as of yet. Okay. She's represented by Dan Toscano.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. Good to be here tonight. Dan Toscano, attorney at law. To my immediate right is Jennifer Pittori, the owner and operator of the new established business Locale, located at 350 Hanover Street. Here with her husband, also operator, employee of the business, so he can be fired at any time. Michael Pittori, standing right in the back. Once again, just to mimic the prior application, this is a conditional use at 350 Hanover Street. It's been zoned as a retail location for many years. We applied to the zoning boards for relief for a restaurant with takeout, 36A. For the past, since 2007, Jeff Pittori operated Hanover News. I think Steve Pascantilli, board member, touched upon it. Tough rents, high rents. Hanover News is just not generating the business that Ms. Pittori would like to establish there. However, with that said, is to go back to what her passion is, what she's done in the past. Since 1992, Jennifer Pittori has operated and owned 3 restaurants, 2 here in the North End, 2 of them located on Prince Street. One was Mineo Pizza, the other one was Sage Restaurant, and then the third restaurant was located on Boylston Street. All establishments had a beer and wine license at the locations. So she has experience working with beer and wine. Since 2007, has come back to the North End and owned and operated Hanover News. What we like to do at this location is a gourmet pizzeria. And basically it's a sit-down restaurant, no paper cups, no paper dishes, fine china, wait service at this location. It's gonna be 9 tables, 18 seats. Everything's gonna be located on the first floor of the establishment, which is approximately 800 square feet. Gonna have an open kitchen concept and the seating right out front. There's not gonna be no open window concept, which I heard in the past. People wanna know if there's gonna be open windows. No open window concept. The facade is gonna remain the same as what you see today. New signage is gonna be put up. Of course, it's gonna be block lettering, classic block lettering with lights behind the lettering to light it up. No neon signage. there will be a vent that goes out into the, which will travel along Tyleston Street, as you can see on your plan. Apologize for not being computer savvy, it's a little small, but it'll be out in the back onto Tyleston Street, which is gonna come out right on the back of the building, won't be seen from Tyleston Street. It's right behind this particular building. It's a little alleyway which separates 350 Hanover Street and the cantina's kitchen. So you're not gonna see the vent coming out, and on the cantina's restaurant, there's the venting on the roof. This one's gonna be on the side. That's where all our trash will be located. It's gonna be contracted with a trash company, which will have daily trash pickup. Barrels are gonna be locked in the alley. The alley is gonna be locked, so no one will be able to get in or out at that location. However, the trash during the course of the business hours will remain inside in the cellar and won't be put out until at night when the establishment closes. I know the North End has concerns with trash going out during the business hours. They may be causing some rodent problems. In turn, speaking about rodents, Mrs. Vittori has contracted with a company that's gonna have rodent control and extermination on a regular basis, probably, I believe, twice a month, if we talked about at this particular location, or at as many times as deemed necessary. Closing hours are gonna be, hours of operation are gonna be 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. from Sunday through Thursday, and Friday and Saturday night from 11 a.m. to midnight. The establishment, as I said, is gonna be a sit-down restaurant. There will be takeout for whole pizzas only. There will not be takeout for individual slices of pizza. Although we are applying for takeout, there will be no delivery at this location, but you're able to call in and order whole pizzas and come in and retrieve them yourself. Second application that we will be filing today, we will be seeking your approval tonight, is for a 7-day beer and wine license with cordials. The application will be filed this week. We anticipate having a hearing date as early as June 13th or June 20th, which is on Wednesdays. The licensing board has their hearing date. As I said earlier, Jennifer has owned and operated a number of establishments here in the neighborhood. All three businesses that they owned and operated all had beer and wine licenses at the location, very familiar with our general laws and working with alcohol. And who wouldn't want a nice slice of pizza, authentic piece of pizza with a nice cold beer and a glass of wine? So with that said, can I answer any questions?
I can just save you some time on that. The council has a policy that the only vote on applications are in front of us. Since you have not filed yet for a liquor license, we are not entertaining that application. We've decided as a council to wait, go through the ZBA and then come back, just as every other.
I respect the board's decision. As soon as I file, we can be put on.
Absolutely.
Can add it to like June 11th, which I'll have more.
You're filling me up on the June agenda already. Just so everybody understands, that's our policy. We only vote on applications that are actually in front of us.
Would it be okay if I may ask the board a question? I see some folks here, Jen and Michael, lifelong residents of the neighborhood. A lot of folks were able to, their busy schedules come out tonight to support them. They may not be here the next council meeting. Maybe council could, you know, maybe a show of hands who's here today that
just
may not be able to
be here. Let's go with our regular procedure. We'll ask the council to ask questions and then we'll open it up to anybody else. Any council members have any questions or comments?
I don't. Did you say you're going to have open windows?
No.
Open windows.
Okay, hours of operation 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. Thursday.
Sunday through Thursday, Friday and Saturday, 11 a.m. to midnight.
Okay, I open it up to the floor. Anybody have any questions or comments?
What's the capacity again? I just take a note.
18 seats, yes.
Anybody want to make a comment?
I got a question too.
Go ahead, George.
Cooking equipment, you're going to be making pizza. You don't have fryers, anything like that.
No fryers.
Do you have an exhaust that goes to the back alley?
It's going to go to the back.
Away from
Hanover Street, and it's not going to be on the roof because there are residents. There's two residential apartments above it, so it's going to be out the back.
Out the back.
So it's in between the alleyway. It's in between the back of this building and Cantina's kitchen.
But that exhaust is not going to interfere with the people in the back, right?
No, there's no back.
One more time, anybody from the council or anybody out there have a question or comment? Would anybody like to entertain a motion? What is in front of us now? It's just the zoning.
Okay, I make a,
I'll be fine. I
make a motion to support the Hanover News to, what is the name of the?
It's not Hanover News, it's
Locale.
Jennifer Court, Trattoria.
Okay, but it was from Hanover News. Application was on Board of Appeals to. To change it to a restaurant with takeout service.
Can we wait before we second it? So the request to hear community support, would that come after the vote, or is that something?
I asked, she's asked twice.
I've asked twice.
And nobody?
Is anybody speaking in support of Jennifer?
I do.
Just get shot, we all come out.
But that's fine, I thought I was clear when I said, does anybody have a comment or?
Everybody made me nervous, they didn't know what's in.
Okay.
So I think it would be important, like Dan said, like, if you're not gonna be here next month and we're voting on this, to know a little bit of background since you're here now about the business owner, it would help the council.
I'm sorry if I caused any confusion, I thought it was clear.
Does everybody understand, we're not gonna be voting on the license today because there hasn't been a filing on the license. We're gonna vote on the change of occupancy. But since some of you may not be here next time, Mr. Toscano recommended that perhaps if you wanna voice your opinion tonight about whether or not you would support the applicant on a petition for a beer and a wine license, you might want to do so today, that's what he suggested.
I live right around the corner from where their other two establishments were. Never had an issue with them, and Michael cleaned so well.
He should have seen you lying and get too clean, that's how.
I support them wholeheartedly.
So do I, and the brand new with her, I agree.
Anybody else wanna make a comment?
I support Jennifer.
Okay.
Well, that's good, I hope you all show up again.
If I may speak as a resident, not a member of the panel today, I did start my first restaurant next to the Trattoria family, and he does clean very well. I don't know about his wife, but Michael.
Yeah, don't put me in that category, we'll move back to him.
I just wanna remind you that clean is not in front of us on the board right now. Great to have those comments, and thank you all for coming out and support. Again, are we all set now? Anybody that feels that they haven't had an opportunity to speak, please do it now. Okay.
I'll make a motion to support Jennifer from Hanover News to a restaurant takeout. And with the hours of 11 to 11, Sunday to Thursday, and Friday and Saturday to 11 to 12.
Okay, and I'm going to just repeat that so it's clear what the motion is. The motion is to support the application of the Zoning Board of Appeals for zoning relief to change the use of the first floor, 350 to 352 Hanover Street, from retail store to a restaurant with takeout service. That is
That's exactly
right now, the zoning change. And we have a second? Okay. All in favor? One, two. Don't give me a It's unanimous. Congratulations. Thank you very much. Moving right along. I don't have to ask you, Jennifer, to be a good neighbor because I've already said that you are. So, 266 Hanover Street, El Camino Express. Francis Pasquale has applied to the licensing board for a new wine and malt license at this location at 266 Hanover Street.
I believe you have the paperwork. Ron actually has made out the application.
I have everything. Yep, I have everything.
Well, once again, good evening. And to my right is Frank DiPasquale. The application that we are here for tonight is Il Panino Express, which is at the corner of Hanover and Parmenter Street. It has been there for the last 18 years. Panino Express is sort of a self-serve, semi-self-serve, light dining, sandwich, pizza, other prepared pastas, and so on and so forth. You'll have to think that most of you have been there at least once in your life. And that restaurant had a beer, wine, and cordial license for 12 years. Frank got into a dispute with the previous owner of the property, Mr. Triolzi, over his lease, at which time he applied to transfer the license from the premises over to the Gelateria, which is on the next block of Hanover. Hanover Street due to the fact that it still remains actually in litigation. The landlord's decision that there would have to be additional payments for the license if he was going to maintain alcohol service at the premises. The building was sold several years ago to the Angelo family. They do not have that provision in the new lease. Frank has executed a 20-year lease for that space, so he will be there for a very long time. He is asking to put a beer, wine, and cordial license back at that location with the same type of service that you see today, the same type of service that had been there for the 12 years that the license was there, all 12 years of which never had a problem, nor has he ever had an incident with that license at the Trattoria, et cetera. For our information, the restaurant is open from between 10 and 11 in the morning, and it closes every night at 11 o'clock at night. As mentioned, it's...
Even on weekends?
Even on the weekends. Yeah, as mentioned, it's a self-serve concept. There's not table service. You go up and pick up your order that you order, that's cooked water for you, and then you go back and sit with it. So he's applying for what would be called an available license, meaning a license from the city. He's not purchasing this from another party, but is applying for a license as it comes available, as has happened recently for a couple of other establishments here in Vermont that have actually received licenses, which is a benefit to anyone who doesn't have to pay for it. So he's made that application. He's actually gone for the hearing a few weeks ago, and again is waiting for results of the boards as well as the eventually the results of the liquor licenses.
Okay. Any other?
I have a quick question.
Go
just
ahead.
To clarify, how is in a self-serve environment, how is alcohol service handled?
It has to be audited from behind a closed area, which it is. You can't have it out in the dining area so that people can self-serve themselves. So you order a glass of wine or you order a bottle of beer and you take it back to your seat.
Jonathan?
Would the hours change at all of operation?
No.
No. So, I'm also trying to get a better understanding. We've had similar requests in front of the councils where there's a movement of license within the same location. And I'm just trying to get a better sense that for myself that the license 12 years ago?
No, the 5.5 years ago was moved out of this location.
It
was there for the prior 12 years.
So what has happened over the past 5.5 years that
change of landlord?
That's why you want to bring it back because of landlord change?
Well, the prior landlord is in litigation with Frank from approximately 6 years ago over the issue of whether he had to pay his additional rent for sale of alcoholic beverages. They could come to an agreement on that, and Frank's decision at the time was to take the license out of there so that wouldn't just continue to escalate.
And then you leased from the same landlord until recently?
No, then the building was sold to Barbara Angelo 2 years ago.
2.5 years ago.
About 2.5 years ago, Frank entered a negotiation for a new lease with her, and we have to get to a 20-year lease.
Where's that?
And then licenses at the Jalapa.
So it stayed within your own business?
It went to his other business.
Or another business.
Yeah.
And then what, over the course of those 2.5 years without a license, is there something that just kind of brings it to the agenda now?
There's a major rent increase. There's a $5,000 rent increase that
It's gonna be tough to make it without a license.
So did you see a drop in revenue once you lost the...
Anybody else? Anybody else have any questions? Go ahead, Ann.
Frank, if you get this license, would you be willing to, if you decide to sell the business, would you give it back to the city rather than try to sell it?
Absolutely. Just that, you answered that.
Yeah, well, he's, as you can tell from a 20-year lease, he's not going anywhere. I don't think that's his concern, is to be selling.
This has happened in the past, sir.
And this is history.
Well, yeah, I mean, there have been other people who have applied, and then, as you say, moved it, but that, again, 18 years at that location, prior to that, Frank's first business in the neighborhood was Il Panino when it was across the street. It was a little sandwich shop, and then came the restaurant. I don't think the concept, that's been his concept for, you know, almost 25 years now. I think it's going to disappear.
Any other council members have any questions or comments? Okay, I open up to all of you out there. Anybody have a question, comment? Nothing?
I support it.
Thank you.
I support it.
Thank you.
Me too.
Support.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, we all support it.
A lot of support here. Okay, thank you very much for your input. Appreciate it. Anybody want to say anything else?
I would just say one thing. I know there's a lot of new faces in the meetings. We don't usually get we get a decent turnout, but there's some people that are here tonight that typically don't come to meetings. But the questions with the beer and wines, just to kind of simplify it for people, is that, you sit down and have a meal, I think you should be able to have a glass of beer and a glass of wine. That's just, and I don't even drink anymore. That's just my opinion. But the problem we have in the neighborhood is sometimes, and it's really not us. We're the middlemen. We support an application, someone gets a beer and wine license, they don't make it, and then all of a sudden, people start playing musical chairs with the beer and wine license. This isn't like, an interrogation of Frankie. We're just asking him that question, because the reality is he's gonna stay in business there. He doesn't usually open up a restaurant and close it because he does a good job with his restaurants for the most part. But that's why we're asking, because people have shifted the licenses around, and some people don't like what they do with the license, so that's why we asked. That's why the question was asked. If you don't make it, which I thought is going to happen, will you keep the beer and wine at that particular location? And we only asked that as a courtesy, because we don't dictate where the licenses go. When the city of Boston issues a beer and wine license, whether they want to restrict it is up to them. It's not up to us. So we're only asking Frank as a courtesy. And if you don't understand, it's just because there's been some beer and wine license issues in the neighborhood recently over the last couple of years, and look at tonight, there's a lot of people asking for beer and wines, and there's a lot of talk about should we cap it, should we this, should we that. And the reality is we're just a neighborhood council that recommends a vote of support or a vote of opposition. But I just wanted to clarify that. I don't want people to think, I know last Thursday's meeting wasn't the nicest environment, I don't think it was very fair myself, but I just wanted to throw that out.
Well, we have a nice environment here. And that's why we like our NEWNC meetings to be run, and we hope it'll continue to be that way. So thank you all for coming. Does anybody else have anything they want to say?
Go ahead. Let me put a motion on the floor.
Let me just give you a point of information about the delayed voter, I think. But anytime a license moves location, they have to come before you the way they have to come before the licensing board for the entire matter, meaning what the hours of operation are, the number of seats, just as if it were a brand new application. The one difference that may be coming up is when you have a license in a location, but you change the owner, and that owner takes the license under the same condition, meaning the same hours of operation, the same seating, etc. It's limited to the qualifications of that person that's buying the license. So when you move them, the city licensing board, as you should, looks at the entire application to determine are the hours appropriate, is the location appropriate, are all the other things appropriate. So that's what you have, that you can use. It's when you have, as Giovanni's, when Giovanni buys that license, technically, and I didn't say it while we did his application, but technically, the only thing that comes before the liquor licensing board is he qualified to operate that license at that location under those conditions. So, again, if it moved next door, it all opens up for anybody who wants to ask them. So.
But I also think that can create a problem because depending upon who they're buying the license from, they're going to carry that baggage with the license, even if that business owner doesn't necessarily have any negative intentions, all that could come with is from who's actually selling.
Right, you know, but you have the opportunity to examine the person who's buying it to determine, you know, what's their background, what experience do they have, what's the history, have they been in another community.
You know, as a council, we can't prevent the person from buying, but person that's acquiring, we can at least ask for some sort of agreements of that.
But the city is still looking for neighborhood support. Yeah. And the city decides, it's regardless of what the application is in for a new license. They're looking for neighborhood support, and then they make the decision regardless of what the neighborhood support is on that license.
Yeah.
So, you know,
the better point to it is that somebody opens a small 12, 18 seat little place and then sells the license to somebody who has 100 seats. You know, you say, wait a minute, when this was 12 or 18 seats, it wasn't so bad, now it's 100 seats. Well, that's a whole new ball of wax. You think they can't say, well, you gave up the license once before, you know, you should get it automatic. So that doesn't happen like that.
I would just want to put one more thing into perspective.
Sure, go right ahead. I just want to walk.
I understand. If any of you don't know, Umberto's has a beer and wine license. You go in for a slice of pizza, right, and you can get a glass of beer, a bottle of beer, and a glass of wine. Just wanted to mention that.
Can I make a motion to the base beer and wine?
Yes.
Okay. First of all, we're going to start by anybody else on the council have any questions or comments? Anybody out there? Okay. Now we'll entertain a motion. Go ahead, Anne.
Okay. I make a motion to support the license for a beer and wine at 266 Hanover Street, up in the Panino Express.
Do I have a second?
Second
the motion? Okay, so what we have before us right now is a motion to Frankie Scotty's applied for a licensing board for a new wine and malt license at 266 Hanover Street. We have a motion to support. It's been seconded. All in favor, raise your hand. Your hand's up.
Yes.
Unanimous. Congratulations.